Hi, this is Aaron Newcomb, and on this episode of Floss Weekly, episode 400, we're going to take a look at some of our past episodes, how the show actually got started. It's going to be a lot of fun. But Simon Phipps is joining me. We're going to talk about Nextcloud. This is the next generation enterprise file and share, sync and share application, kind of like ownCloud. We'll find out what the differences are. That's coming up right now on Floss Weekly.
Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is Twit.
Bandwidth for Floss Weekly is provided by CashFly at CacheFly.com.
This is Floss Weekly with Aaron Newcomb and Simon Phipps, episode 400, recorded on August 23rd, 2016, Nextcloud. Hey everybody, it's time for Floss Weekly, the show about free Libre open source software. And I have to say that today especially because today is a special day indeed. It is our 400th episode. Can you believe it? 400 episodes. We were looking at this before, looking up the history a little bit, and it turns out that we've been doing this show collectively. Twit has been doing this show for over 10 years. Does not seem possible at all. But we've been doing this show for over 10 years, and we've done 400 episodes if you include today's episode. And so we're going to celebrate a little bit today and talk about a little bit about the history before we bring on our guest in a little bit. But before we get to all that, I want to bring on my lovely co-host, Simon Phipps. Simon, how's it going?
It's going pretty well. I'm here in a very hot, unusually hot United Kingdom. I'm surrounded by screens to keep the room even warmer, and delighted to be back on the show again.
Great. Excellent. Well, thanks for joining me. We don't interact on the show together enough, I think. So it's always good to talk to you. And I think you're going to have some insights on our topic today for sure. And I should mention, too, that Randall is out. If you haven't caught up with the past couple episodes, Randall's out on sick leave, and we hope he's feeling better and returns soon. So that being said, let's go ahead and talk a little bit about the history of Floss Weekly. And we're going to play some audio clips. So one thing to note is that this show started very early on the Twit network. It was one of the first shows after the Twit show, the main show, started. It was one of the first shows, I think, that Leo did or added to the roster, if you will. And back then, everything was audio only. There wasn't any video yet. And so the clips that we're going to be playing today are actually audio only. So don't adjust your screen. These are going to be audio clips that we're going to take a listen to. And let's start with the very first, because we need to go back to the beginning, the very first episode of Floss Weekly. And it was actually Leo and Chris DeBona who was hosting the show for the first, few episodes, or maybe 20 or so episodes. And so, you know, the music was different and they were just getting the show going, and they did this short little episode. You can go back and watch all these, by the way, if you go to twit.tv and go to Floss and just scroll through to the end. All of the episodes are archived. But the very first episode was kind of short. They just introduced the concept of the show. It was about 20 minutes long and they just got going like that. So without further ado, let's go ahead and listen to the very first episode of Floss Weekly.
Hello, open sourcers, wherever you are. Leo Laporte here, announcing a brand new podcast, new part of the Twit.tv family. One I've wanted to do for a long time. And in fact, if I hadn't erased all the recordings we did, we would have done a long time ago. Let me introduce your host for this podcast, Mr. Chris DeBona.
Hello, everybody.
An old friend. Chris used to be a regular on the Screensavers talking about open source. That's back when you were at OSDN, I think, right?
Whoa.
And then there's a... Yeah, that was one, and then we're going to switch to the next one. So as you can see, the music was different back then, and if you're into open source, you're called an open sourcer. So I'm going to make a shirt that says I'm an open sourcer. Well, let's hear what. Go ahead.
I just got my sign here. Come in, we're open. Yeah, nice. That audio you heard there was from April 2006. And
yes.
If anyone's interested in tracking through all this history, it's actually all on Wikipedia. There are some loving hands create a complete list of all the shows we've ever had, complete with links to the guests. So you can look them up on Wikipedia as well. So while we're going through all this, you can find out all about the guests and the topics by looking up on that page as well as on twit.tv. Oh, sorry, yes. Back to you, Aaron.
Awesome. No, thank you. We were just talking about that before the show. You brought up the fact that there was this wiki page that has all this history on it. I think it's awesome. So let's hear now what Chris DeBona, how he described how the show was going to work.
So thank you. And we look forward to this weekly. It's going to be called FLOSS Weekly. Do you want to explain what FLOSS means?
Okay. So one of the ways that people talk about open source software is they use an acronym. And sometimes it's OSS for open source software, or FOSS or free or open source software. And sometimes people say FLOSS because it's even more annoying. Because it's free, libre, Spanish for free, open source software.
And so, I guess the idea was that the word libre in Spanish is really a better description of what free means in this context.
Yeah, because I mean, a lot of people think this is about money, and in fact, it's not. It's about the freedom to do with the software what you please.
It's not gratis. It's free.
Yes.
It's free as in a free as the wind. Free.
Yeah, although it is worth saying that the open source definition is pretty clear that you cannot charge per se for the software. You know, even though you can charge for services around it,
right,
for delivering it and putting on a CD or something.
But, one of the things that I've started to realize, we're in a kind of interesting era now where people are giving a lot of stuff away and they're not worrying so much about how they're going to make money. I mean, podcasts is a good example. A lot of what you see on the web now, open source software really started all this. And I think it's fantastic because people are, in fact, able to make a living by mm-hmm. giving stuff away. And it's a whole new world thing. And I think we can thank people like Richard Stallman and the open source community for saying, you know, you don't have to be greedy and you can still make make dinner and live.
There you go. I love how Leo made the connection there between, what he did, because he really had that concept for the Twit Network early on, is that he wasn't, these are podcasts. He's not going to charge for them. He's going to let. And that was up in the air back in those days. Remember, this is 10 years ago when people were, podcasts were new in the concept of are these going to be on iTunes and you're going to have to download them. Everything was on iTunes back then. So that was kind of new. And so kudos to Leo first, number one, for not charging for all of these podcasts. You can watch them free, which turned out to be the right model. And then number two, for making one of his early shows, FLOSS Weekly, a show about open source software. I think that's great. I would take time because, Simon, real quick, any comments about what Leo was saying in terms of the charging aspect, whether you charge for open source software or not?
No, I thought it was great what Leo was saying there. And the only thing that upsets me about the world of free Libre and open source software is 10 years on, we've just been having an argument or a discussion on the internet about MariaDB has just made one of their pieces of software closed source. They've made it proprietary. Because they think you have to withhold permission in order to make money with open source. And it seems that although people have, long understood that open source software is something where you can make a living if you pick a business model where that's possible, people still insist on picking business models where you have to use proprietary software in order to win. And
right.
So, I find it's fascinating that people like Leo have been making a go of this for a decade. People like Red Hat have been succeeding with it for, even longer. And yet there's still people today who are deciding that they have to take things proprietary in order to make money. And, it would be good to dig into that, because I think when we talk to Frank later, we can ask some questions about that, too.
Yeah, absolutely. I wanted to at least get your opinion on that, because I know you've been talking about this for a long time. But let's move right along, because we do want to get to our guests. So next up, we have so what happened was the show, it was hard to schedule. Chris had a busy schedule. He's working for Google, and, it was hard to get the show going. And, the show basically, we called it FLOSS Weekly, but it was, kind of like FLOSS sometimes. It would come out maybe, once a month or once every other week. And so it was kind of hit or miss. And so Chris finally decided he couldn't do it. And then Leo asked Randall, who had been on the show during that stint, to come on and maybe do some shows and maybe host the show. And so let's take a listen real quick to Randall's first appearance on FLOSS Weekly, or first appearance as a host. There, the music's back. Familiar music.
This is FLOSS Weekly with Randall Schwartz and Leo Laporte. Episode 18 for July 20th, 2007. Josh Berkus of PostgreSQL. It's been a long time since we've had a Floss Weekly. In fact, a few of you are probably kind of shocked to see something in your feed reader on your iTunes. But Floss is back. I'm not going to call it weekly yet. I have high hopes.
Well, let's not call it Floss quarterly.
Yeah, no, it's been quarterly, and that's not worked either. Chris DeBona, who's been our great host, is, I think, still part of the team, but is so busy with his new baby and, of course, his duties at Google that it's just been very difficult for us to get together and do some interviews. Thankfully, Randall Schwartz, who has been on Floss Weekly, is here to has very kindly volunteered to at least wrangle a few people to talk to and get a few shows up.
Thank you for inviting me to be someone who can wrangle some people for you.
I appreciate it. Well, of course, you're well known in the Floss community as the author of, a dozen Pearl books?
Yeah, I lost count. It's quite a few, but my name's been in print 27 million times. That's all I remember.
And in the Linux, Linux Journal? Where do you?
Linux Magazine, up until recently, Unix Review Magazine, and a bunch of other places. And in fact, I've got a couple new things in the works, so I'll be in a few more places as well.
So there you go. So that was Randall's first appearance as a host. Like I said, he had been on the show previously as a guest talking about Perl and other things. And of course, Randall has shepherded the show through, the bulk of the 400 episodes that we have now. So big thanks to Randall. Like I said, we hope he gets better soon. Wish he could be here for this, but we'll talk about it a little bit maybe when we have him on again. But anyway, so that's how Randall made his appearance. And amazingly, Randall's been doing this for, 9 years or so, getting guests together. It's a lot of work, folks, putting this show together, doing the scheduling, sending out the information, what's your project about, all that kind of stuff, boiling it down into what we call a rundown that we can use on the show here. And then, guiding the conversation every week. It's really a lot of work. So, huge thanks to him for doing that. Real quickly, I wanted to, since Simon and I are on, I figured we might as well have our first appearances on the show. So my first appearance was actually, I was at Sun Microsystems at the time, and I came on to talk about ZFS. I thought it was important to talk about, with the open source community, trying to promote that file system and all the good work that Sun was doing around it at the time. And so I came in to talk about ZFS. The funny thing was, though, I was late. I got stuck in traffic and I was late to the show. They were already talking at the time. The show was running and I kind of like snuck in. This was back in the cottage. I snuck in around the table and sat down and I was so flustered. You probably hear it in my voice. Leo said, "Say hello to everybody." And I think I said like, "Hi guys," or something. I didn't say anything. So let's take a quick listen to my first appearance on Floss Weekly as a guest.
Now let us go to Simon Phipps. I think he is in England right now.
Actually, we can do that one. Do you want to do the other one, John? That's fine. Whichever one you pull up. If you want to do that one, we can do the Simon one. So Simon, yours was, I believe you were talking about your responsibilities as chief open source officer. Is that correct?
Yep.
At Sun Microsystems?
That's right. That was episode 39. So that was about a year. Just looking at the list here, that was about a year before you were on.
Yep.
Interestingly, it shows up as you co-hosting it.
That's the normal hosts are listed on the web page.
So yes, that was episode 39. I'm just looking through the list here. There were quite a few people who are were Sun staff showing up as guests on the show, because I see that six eps before that there was Bruno Salzer and Dalibor mm-hmm. Topic talking about OpenJDK, and then there's me on talking about Sun Microsystems and our move towards open source then, and then a little while later there's you talking about ZFS, as we call it over here in the mother country,
right.
There was some people showing up remarkably often. It must have been blowing people's minds, because as I recall, Sun wasn't flavor of the month in the open source community back in the in 2007-2008.
Right. Yeah, it was kind of it wasn't tumultuous times, but it was just kind of like, oh, really? Sun's doing this now? Like, I think there was some people couldn't believe it at first. But you did a great job back in those days. So let's listen to since John has that one queued up, let's listen to Simon's first appearance on Floss Weekly.
Now let us go to Simon Phipps. I think he is in England right now, Southampton. Simon,
sitting here in my home studio with my cup of tea.
Oh, how nice! In Southampton.
He still is. In Southampton, on the sunny south coast of England. Actually, it was sunny a couple of days ago.
Once. So that's
a good omen for it being sunny again sometime in the next decade.
It's great to talk to you, Simon. How long have you been at Sun?
I've been at Sun now for 8 years. I moved there from IBM in 2000.
And were you always in charge of open source there? Or?
No, I moved into Sun to look after... Well, in actual fact, I would say that I was hired out of IBM so that I wouldn't work at IBM anymore. I spent about 2 years doing nothing of significant value at Sun, simply so that I wouldn't work for anybody else.
Oh, how frustrating. I mean, flattering, but frustrating.
Flattering and very frustrating. And it was really frustrating, but it is very nice to be paid a salary for doing absolutely nothing.
What did you do in those 2 years?
I visited Java communities, visited open source communities. Tinkered with philosophical ideas around Sun's business propositions, got involved in some of the products that Sun was launching and got largely ignored by the product teams. All sorts of random stuff for a couple of years. And then I gradually started getting drawn into open source. And it turned out Denise Cooper had been working on open source at Sun for a couple of years. And there was more going on than she could cope with in her time. So I would attend things in the countries she didn't want to go to, and she would attend things in the countries I didn't want to go to, and we kind of had a happy symbiosis. And then when Sun finally became too toxic for her and she moved on to another company, I managed to get the open source beat upgraded to director level from from ground level. And that was about the same time that Jonathan Schwartz became the chief executive. And he and I discussed how we were going to upscale open source at Sun. And we agreed that I would be his chief open source officer and would try and make sure that Sun did open source in a way that was legal, decent, honest, and truthful. And the heart of what we were doing was actually an open source heart rather than it just being an open source marketing position.
Yeah, that's great. So so many things there. I want you to respond to that a little bit, Simon. But I love the part, a couple of things, right? I love the part about how, you basically didn't have a whole lot to do when you were first hired. It's like, it seems when you're a kid, that's like, oh, that's everybody's dream job. But when you're actually in that situation, you're like, oh, I'm so bored. Like, I've got to find something to do. So is that, I mean, obviously, that must be all true, right? I mean, does that bring you back to the days of being the chief open source officer at Sun?
Yeah. So that experience of not doing anything, it's how I started at Sun, and then it's the last year at Sun after Oracle had acquired the company, and they did the due diligence on Sun after acquiring it, and so all of us who were in positions of responsibility at Sun that year were told to do absolutely nothing. Because Oracle hadn't decided what they were going to do with us yet. So I was in the job, but had nothing to do for a whole year until finally leaving the company. The bit in the middle working on open source was tremendous. I had a fantastic team of people. We were able to do things that were of great significance to free and open source software, like release Java as open source, like releasing all of the identity middleware as open source. In fact, we released everything that Sun made as open source, apart from the Spark compiler, because that team refused to make their product open source, but everybody else did, and that's made a huge difference to the subsequent history of the software industry and of the free and open source software movement. I'm quite proud of what we were able to do as a collective team in Sun, working on open source in those days. And the fact that it was bracketed by two periods of idleness while the company didn't quite know what to do with me, and latterly as Oracle knew exactly what they wanted to do with me but couldn't find an excuse, the bit in the middle, the sandwich, was fantastic.
Yeah, definitely. And I was part of that transition as well. I remember those days quite well.
I don't know if I ever told you this. An interesting tidbit about this is the reason that I applied to Sun and chose to work for Sun was because of their stance on open source. So they started coming out in favor of open source, and I saw all this great stuff they want to do, and I said, hey, you know, maybe I might want to check this company out. And it's the whole reason I applied. If they hadn't done the stuff around open source, I wouldn't have ever worked for Sun Microsystems. So thank you very much, Simon, for your role in that.
Great.
Because yeah, you gave me a job for a few years at least. I don't know how long it was, 5 years or whatever, at Sun Microsystems, and I loved it. I still look back very fondly on those days because Sun was doing such cool things back then. And that's coming from two insiders, right? I mean, I don't know how it looked from the outside, but from the inside, Sun was really doubling down on open source and doing some great stuff. Okay, so we got to move on. I think the next one is going to be my first appearance on FLOSS Weekly. And I already told you I was running late, a little bit flustered. So let's hear a little bit about that. It's a short
clip. Who are we talking to this week?
We are talking to the people that can tell us about ZFS, the file system that Sun created it has compression built in, it has replication built in, it automatically allocates itself to storage sizes, so you don't have to have like one small drive, one large drive, and have to deal with changing the sizes on those. It's quite cool, and I understand it's going to be in Snow Leopard as well, which is the next release of the OS X operating system. And I understand it's also going to be, I think there's versions of it that run with Linux and BSD as well. I think we'll have to get in and ask them all the details about that. But we've got with us, in studio, in fact, coming in any moment now, Aaron Newcomb, who is, I believe, somebody involved in the sort of the community side of ZFS. And we also have David Brittle. He'll be phoning in soon. We'll get him on the phone. He's one of the lead developers on ZFS.
So Aaron has texted us that he's going to be here in 5 minutes. Mm-hmm. But meanwhile, David is on the line. Let's get David in and start the conversation about ZFS.
Okay, so that was the intro, and then here's where I come in after probably about 10 more minutes of being stuck in traffic.
So Aaron has come in. Let me pause for a moment, and Aaron Newcomb has joined us.
You may say hello, Aaron.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
So, Aaron, what's your relationship to David?
Right. So David is more, he's in charge of the engineers that are actually working on the product, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so what I do is I take the output of that, what David brings to the table, so to speak, and I work on putting that in forms that can be a little bit more easily consumed.
You're kind of
so
packaging it.
Exactly.
Yeah,
yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
There we go. That was it. That was the high level description. I had no idea what I was saying at that point. I was so flustered just from being late. And, for me, that was a big deal. It was the first time on the Twit network. And, you know, I wanted to really give a good impression and represent the ZFS community well. And, I was running late and, but, you know, you heard all that stuff in the beginning. I mean, there was a lot of talk in the beginning about where ZFS was going to go. Was it going to go into mainstream Linux? Was it, going to go into Mac OS? And there was all of these great ideas about ZFS was going to take over the world. And of course, most of that didn't happen the way we expected. It's still a great file system. And now, of course, you can run it under Linux. Those things happened a little differently than we expected back then. Still a great product, though. If you need a great file system, I still recommend people go check it out, especially if they're doing stuff on white box and they want to have a nice file system in the background that just works. It's a great, great one to go check out. So that was the history. That's the history of FLOSS in a nutshell. I thought it might be fun to do. Hopefully you found it fun to listen to some of those old clips, especially if you weren't listening back in the day when we first started all of this stuff. And boy, what a great ride it's been. 400 episodes. Congratulations to everybody. You know, we would be remiss if we didn't also recognize John for his role, because John came in early on. You know, Leo was kind of doing this in the cottage in the early days. He was kind of doing it himself. But then very quickly he started hiring people, and John came on. I don't know if John's on, but I can't remember exactly when you came on board, but it was very, very early, John. And you've 2009, and you've been TE for this show, the technical engineer for this show for basically ever since then, I think. And Boy, you just do such a great job every week, John. So a big shout out to John, who is extremely tired from putting together the new studio.
Absolutely.
That's right. Let's give him a hand.
There he is. So the thing I know about John is John's been willing to get up at the crack of dawn to do this show, because that's the slot that's available. Look at him there all on his own in a dark studio. No one else from Twit TV is going to be getting in till lunchtime. And he's going to be there all on his own simply because we've got to do this show at a time of day that people like me are still in daylight. So all right. Great stuff. Thank you very much, John, for all that effort you've put in and the early mornings that you've done over the years.
Absolutely. Absolutely. We couldn't have done the show without John. He just makes it work every week. You know, we ask something new of him and he seems to be able to make it happen every time. So we really appreciate all his work over the years. Okay. Now that was the background. We do have a guest today that we need to get to. And we're kind of running late. I know, Simon, I think you've got some things to get to here in a little bit. So let's try to get this thing going and talk to our guest a little bit. So let's bring him on. Our guest today is Frank. I'm going to have to ask him how to pronounce his name because I didn't do it before the show started. Frank Karlitschek, maybe? We'll see. He started the ownCloud project. And in fact, he was on the show talking about ownCloud. If you want to go look at that episode, it's episode 274. And he started that project back in 2010 to return control over the storing and sharing of information to consumers. And a lot of you probably know about ownCloud or have used ownCloud before. But in 2016, he started the Nextcloud project to bring his idea to the next level. And he's been involved with a variety of free software projects, including having been a board member for the KDE community. So he's got a long history in this stuff, and he's here today to talk about Nextcloud. So Frank, welcome to the show.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for having me again. First, I want to say that congratulations to 400 episodes of FLOSS Weekly. This is really amazing. I mean, this is really, I think, 10 years you said. So that's really, I mean, one of the longest running podcasts, I think, at least in this space. So really, congratulations from me.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think there's only a few that I can think of that, especially around open source software, that have been running longer. I think Linux Link Tech Show might still be running. So they, if they're still going, and I think they are, I think they started just before, maybe like a year before this podcast started. So, but not very many other ones out there. I know I started two open source podcasts myself, and both of them only lasted about a year, year and a half. So, definitely a long time. How did I do on your last name, by the way? Maybe you could say it for us just to correct my.
It's Karlitschek. Karlitschek.
Karlitschek.
Karlitschek. Yes, but it doesn't matter. Say it however you want. All kinds of different ways of spelling it or saying it. So
we'll just call you Frank and
Frank,
leave it
Frank,
at that and apologize for my poor American ability to speak other languages. And where are you actually speaking to us from?
I'm from Germany, in Stuttgart here, south of Germany. So also same as Simon, a little bit of daylight still here. So yeah. Thanks for having me again.
Yeah, absolutely. So you started ownCloud, and then at some point something happened, and I don't know what it was. You're going to tell us, and then Nextcloud came about. So maybe first explain why the shift. Why did you go from ownCloud to Nextcloud? Are they the same thing? How are they related?
Yeah. Excellent question. So as you mentioned, I started the ownCloud project 6.5 years ago. Long time now, and the idea is it was started as a pure open source project, so open source and free software project, which at the beginning I basically did the first version alone, and then more contributors came in and they grew, the community grew, the user base grew, the product, the software grew, and really in a very nice open source way and open source fashion. And then 1.5 years later, I got in contact with my two co-founders, and we discussed the option to create a company around it. And then we founded ownCloud Inc. At the time, company based in the US. And the idea was to basically sell an enterprise version of ownCloud to companies, to big corporations, big organizations, universities, and so on. And this was was really successful for some time. So ownCloud at the time, we were able to hire some of the people from the community basically bring this product, bring the software and everything to the next level. My idea was always to basically try to do some kind of experiment or basically try to do something which is an open source project, an open source community and a company both at the same time, and to have a nice balance, so it's a win-win situation for both sides. And this was worked quite well for some time, but after a while, it basically it's no longer was basically in the balance wasn't that good anymore, I think. And this was not only what I my impression, but also the impression from lots of the community people, because this was special because I think we employed like, I don't know, like 20 developers at a time. But of course, the community, the open source contributor community was, I think we reached like 1,000 contributors at a time. So it was really a combination of full-time people paid to do the work and also people from the outside who contributed to it. And I just thought, and this was also the impression of most of the core developers too, that the balance wasn't that good anymore. And there were some other things like different ideas how to move forward with our investors and our management. And basically, the original idea to have like both in balance, it wasn't working out that well anymore. And at some point, we reached the consensus. Basically, most of the core people and community people that I talked to and myself, that we basically want to do improve a few things. And we basically then, did the fork to Nextcloud. And Nextcloud, again, is an open source project and also a company. So it just didn't change. But I think the balance is better this time. So we basically do this now to as a reboot to reach the next level of this.
Okay. And just from looking at the website, when I was preparing for the show, it looks like one of the differences here is, and I mean, I could be wrong, but it seems like Nextcloud is more focused, maybe a little bit more on the enterprise, at least from the company perspective. It's focused mostly on enterprises setting up their own cloud storage systems. Is that accurate? Or maybe you tell us, what's the difference between the two?
Yeah, I mean the product itself obviously reached a certain maturity levels that we're really targeting, enterprises and bigger organizations with it. But this doesn't necessarily has to mean that we as a company basically are more closed or more a bigger distance from the community, actually the opposite. So if you ask what the main difference is, then I think the main difference is that we want to be more open and work closer with the community. So just to give a few examples, ownCloud was developed at the end when there was the company as an open core model. So basically the ownCloud core itself was open source, but there were some proprietary enterprise extensions running on top of it. And those enterprise extensions, they were not open source, they were not free software. You have to pay for that. So it's a classic open core model. And this is something which I don't think is the best model going forward. And with Nextcloud, everything is open source. The only thing we do is everything is free software, open source, HEPL licensed, so we don't have any proprietary extensions. Another thing that we do differently is that we no longer require a contributor license agreement. So I don't know how many of you here on the show are familiar with that. It's basically a contract that every contributor has to sign, which basically gives the full copyright, the full rights on the work and the contribution to the company, so that the company can do some dual licensing and some other things they want to do with the intellectual property. And this is another thing which I and most of the community contributors think it's not really fair. So if someone contributes to Nextcloud, they should own the code. I mean, and this all should be run and released under free software. So, and there's more like with the trademark and other things. We basically want to handle this in a more open, more community-friendly way.
Right. Now, didn't you have you created a foundation to host Nextcloud as well, Carl?
Yeah, we're in the process of creating a foundation, and this foundation will own the trademark. So the Nextcloud trademark will be owned by the foundation, not by the company, which means that if the company at some point, and we will have some criteria, so if the company, for example, is no longer developing everything as open source, or the company is bought by another company, or if the company goes out of business, or certain other things happen, then the foundation can basically reject the trademark, take it back, and give the trademark to someone else, which means Nextcloud as a trademark will always be protected, will always be available for the open source project, and basically all the commercial interests that are still good and valid, but that no longer have the power to basically risk the full open source project.
Right. So the foundation will give the company an exclusive license to the trademark,
exactly.
which you can revoke in the event that the company
exactly.
behaves in a way that isn't acceptable to the community. That's exactly what I wanted to do with MariaDB, actually. But
really?
The company wouldn't agree to limiting their use of the trademark, and you saw this week that they've abused it by putting it as part of the name of a proprietary product. So, you know, I think
yes.
the step you've taken there of anchoring in a foundation, of not allowing, you know, the problem that you talked about there of centralizing all the copyright through a copyright assignment.
Yes.
Again, we've seen an example this week that MariaDB Corporation has been able, because they owned all the copyright to their Mac scale product, they've been able to put it under a proprietary license.
Yes,
whereas
exactly
you won't be able to do that because
exactly.
your contributors
yeah.
will all own the individual copyrights of
yes.
the code. Your code is under a license that's a plus license. Is it? What are you using? Is it AGPL that you're using?
Yes, we use the AGPL version 3 plus, which means at some point if the Free Software Foundation comes up with AGPL version 4, for example, it's automatically used too. So,
right.
This is exactly as you said. I think this is basically some kind of insurance for the community that their contribution can never basically taken away or misused by the company. And this is something that's a proven model, I think. I mean, if you look at the biggest open source project, which is the Linux kernel, that's exactly the same model. There's no contributor agreement. Red Hat and SUSE and all the other companies, they don't really own the code. But they can still build a business model around it by packaging it and selling support and consulting and certification and so on for it. And this is exactly the business model we want to do with our company. So I think this is just a very fair model, which is better than what we did at ownCloud.
Yeah. Right. So, Frank, why on earth did ownCloud decide to do open core and to not respect the freedoms of their customers? What went wrong?
I mean, I don't want to talk too much about the internals here, but there were just like lots of different interests there. I mean, ownCloud got funding, ownCloud Inc. Got funding by some venture capital companies. They have certain interests, how the product should develop and what the intellectual property should be, that should be owned by the company, so that then later when they want to sell the company to a bigger company because then they want to make the money, then there is something they can sell. And there are some other interests, and this is basically how it developed. And this is something that most of the core contributor group and me, myself, learned over time that this is not really sustainable. So we want to do this better this time.
Right, right. So you've got a good strong base now. You've got the code with distributed ownership. Presumably
yeah.
some of the code still belongs to ownCloud as a corporation. Presumably
yeah.
you and all the people who came with you from ownCloud have brought a whole load of the copyright ownership with you as well. So you're going to be able to have at least a piece of ownership of the code. You've got a foundation in place. Are you seeing the ownCloud community joining you now at Nextcloud? Have you seen a lot of people come across and start working with you?
Well, it's a bit early to say, right? It's just basically a little bit over 2 months now. But if you look at the statistics, basically the contributor statistics or the commit statistic on GitHub, then you can see that most of the community people basically like our model better and moved over. And also it seems that most of the app developers, because ownCloud and Nextcloud has this concept of apps, they are basically plugins or extensions. And it seems that also most of these app developers also like the open nature we have here at Nextcloud better, and they're all moved over, or not all, but a lot moved over. So it seems that we have the momentum on our side, but it's hard to say. Let's see in a few months. But it looks
right.
very promising and good so far.
So you've got that good solid base. So, you know, now let's set that past behind you.
Mm-hmm.
What are you going to do to make Nextcloud a product that people want to have in addition to all those freedoms? What are you going to do to make it great?
Yeah, that's an excellent question, because it's, I don't think it's really healthy to look back and to basically talk about the past so much. Obviously, the first question is always exactly as your first question. Hey, what happened and what do you do different? And we have something to say here. But of course, looking forward is the right thing to do. So I think that Nextcloud is basically, I mean, it all started as some kind of file sync and share product. You could, the elevator pitch was also always something like, okay, it's like Dropbox, but it's open source and you can host it yourself. And of course, this is something Nextcloud can do and can do for many, many years. But I think this is not the end of the road. This is like just the beginning. At the end of the day, Nextcloud is something that can connect to all kinds of different storages. So if you have a, I don't know, have an NFS share there, an FTP server, or you have an, a SharePoint or whatever storage, we can integrate that and we can basically provide it to the users through all kinds of different channels, with mobile clients and desktop clients and web interfaces and web dev mounts and so on and so on. And of course, we can also do things with the with the data, with the files. So we have a, like a file firewall feature where we can define certain rules, which data flows to where. We have a workflow engine where we can define different things, how the data is what happens if files uploaded or downloaded or shared or something. So it's really, it's becoming more like a file broker, like a central instance where basically all the files that you as a person have or as a corporation have, it basically can integrate into different sources and push it into other sources. But this is only the files aspect. So obviously, we also want to do more than just files. So one big change that we do differently in Nextcloud is that we integrate more communication and collaboration features. So there's an open source project called Spreadme, which is a WebRTC-based video and voice conferencing system, and this will be integrated into Nextcloud. So in the future, when you work with your files and you have a shared folder, you can already write a comment, and in the future you can click on a person, like in the comments, for example, and say, I want to chat with this person, I want to directly call this person, and then you have a voice call or video call with someone, can directly work on the same files, maybe in a collaborative way, or writing comments, or chat with it. So it's more becoming more like a central hub for all kinds of files and communication features.
Yeah, that's what I was going to ask, because it seems like, I know at least on the website, it says that you interact with calendars, contacts, mail, things like that. So, I mean, yeah, it seems like this is becoming much more than just file sharing or just a place to put files, but it's actually, like you said, it sounds like you're integrating more metadata, things like that. I mean, talk about the integration with email, for example, or calendars. How does that work?
That's a great topic, because very early it became clear that people, I mean, our community people, that they want to have a nice email interface also in ownCloud and Nextcloud, and they want to have a calendar that can synchronize with your phone and contacts, and you can share everything. You can basically do everything you can do with Google nowadays. And this is something that is super, super popular. I don't have any statistics about our user base, but every time I talk with a user, they say, well, I love the calendar and the contacts and everything. Of course, they also use the file sharing and syncing part, but I also like the collaborative pieces. And this is something that at ownCloud, we basically never really support or never really pushed forward, because, well, it was the definition that we are a file sync and share company and product. And if you look at the Gartner definition, for example, or how certain analysts see this market, it's basically file sync and share. And there's no space for calendar or mail. But we are a community and a company and a product now who wants to listen more what the users really want. And so we will actively support mail integration, chat integration, calendar integration, and all the things that actually our community really loves.
And so, speaking of the community, when you talk about email integration and calendar integration, will this be integration into just Google and Microsoft products, or you know, would it include other things as well, like Evolution or any of the other clients?
Yeah, I should be more precise, of course. That's a good point. So if you look at the calendar and the context integration, the Nextcloud actually is a full calendar server and a full address book or contact server. So it can speak CalDAV and CartDAV, which means from your phone and your desktop, you can directly synchronize your calendar and contact with it. And in the web interface, Nextcloud has a really nice web interface where you can look at your calendar and move stuff around and edit data and add new data and so on. And of course, you can also share with others. So this is basically your full calendar replacement. And then if you look at other features like the mail integration, Nextcloud is not a full mail server. I think this would be out of scope. But if you have a mail server that speaks IMAP, for example, it could be like just an open source IMAP daemon running on the same machine, or maybe you have a mail server in your company or you just use Gmail or something else, then you can use Nextcloud as a very nice web interface on front of that. But we are not re-implementing a mail server in PHP. I don't think this would be a good idea.
Right. Okay, good. Thanks for clarifying. The other question I had is about your, I guess, current competition. I mean, I think that, mm-hmm. you know, I think when I think ownCloud, I think, oh, it's like the, you know, the alternative to Dropbox, for example. Mm-hmm. Is Dropbox still kind of your primary competitor, or, you know, what other services are like this that you're trying to compete yeah. with or do better than?
Yeah, I mean, it's always a question how you define this, what a competitor really is. I mean, from a user experience perspective, something like Dropbox or Google Drive or even OneDrive from Microsoft, I think they're from the feature and from a user experience perspective, competitors. Of course, there are also a few fundamental differences, like Nextcloud you can host yourself. Like you can't host Google or can't host like Dropbox. That's different, and obviously, as I said before, everything is completely open source. And then if you look at things that are has this functionality, are self-hosted and open source, then there is not a lot of competition. I mean, obviously, ownCloud at the moment, and there are some other projects like Pydio, for example. But in this space, there's actually not a lot of competition. But you're right, of course. The question is always for the users, do you want to host it yourself? Do you care about open source free software at all? And a lot of people don't care. They're just happy with signing up at Dropbox and they have no interest in owning their data or really knowing what's happening on the server. And yeah, well, that's then, of course, totally different.
Yeah. I noticed on your website, too, there's something called the Spreed box. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that correctly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What in the world is a Spreed box?
So Spreed is this feature that is integrated into Nextcloud, which is this WebRTC video and voice teleconferencing system. So you can basically, it's a full WebRTC server, and you can directly do full video calls and voice calls directly from within Nextcloud. So in the future, hopefully next time, we can do this interview directly with Spreed with completely free software. We don't have to use Skype anymore, hopefully. And that's a feature that's fully integrated into Nextcloud. And the Spreed box, it's basically a small device. It's a small box with an ARM chip in it and some memory card and network interfaces and the software Nextcloud with Spreed pre-installed. So this is something, a box that you can buy, you can put it at home or you can put it into your small company, and then you have your own little, well, first of all, file server if you want, but also your communication hub in a way. So you can use all your video calls inside your company or with your friends or with customers with this box, and that's the Spreed box.
Okay, so this is, I was thinking this is something that you developed, but it's not. Spreed box is a separate project, and and Nextcloud is integrated into that.
Yeah, well, it's basically a product of our sister company here. So when we founded Nextcloud, we did this together with a company called the Struktur AG here in Germany, and they have this product, Spreadbox. So it's basically, it's not done by us, but it's very related. In fact, it's we share the office with them. So it's really,
nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, and do they follow the same open source principles as Nextcloud?
Yes, exactly.
Oh, that's great.
So Spreadme is 100% open source, no proprietary code, everything is hosted on GitHub. And the same with the software that's running on the Spreadbox. Yes, 100% open source, free software.
Awesome. And, you know, I noticed that, like, a lot of the installation docs and things like that are very similar to the ownCloud.
Yeah.
And I've got ownCloud running, like I mentioned, on a chip computer, the little $9 computer that came out recently. It was it's very highly publicized Kickstarter campaign. And yeah. It seems to be working okay, although I can't get it up and running today, but that's probably because I messed something up. So can I, I guess this is a little self-serving for me since I do a lot with these small devices, Raspberry Pis and so on. Can I run Nextcloud on those type of devices the same way I would run ownCloud?
Absolutely. So the current version at the moment is Nextcloud 9, which is just a complete Dropbox, drop-in replacement. A drop-in replacement. It's also a Dropbox replacement, to be honest.
There you go, yeah. There you go.
No, it's a drop-in replacement, so you can take your own cloud installation and replace it with Nextcloud, and everything works as before, but you have a few more features, and yeah. You can do that. And in fact, actually, in the next 2 days, we will release Nextcloud 10, which then has a few more features and also a few more enterprise features that we re-implemented as free software. And yeah, you can absolutely upgrade to that, and it should be super easy. And yeah, also the documentation, how to do that, it's very, very similar. I mean, obviously, we will have high goals, so we want to do all the installation and the upgrading easier than in the past, but at the moment you can follow just the same tutorials.
I was going to ask about that in terms of what's coming next. So you mentioned that release 9 or 10. I mean, what are the differences? What should people be expecting? What new features are there?
Yeah. So if you compare Nextcloud 10 with the latest version from ownCloud, you already get a bunch of more features that you don't have somewhere else. There are a few improvements around security. So we already come with a brute force login protection. So if you run your service on the internet and you want to protect it against just a brute force password crack attack, then there's already functionality in it which blocks failed login attempts from specific IPs after a while. We have very nice monitoring extension, so you can in the admin page can already see your CPU load and your memory usage and how many users, active users, how many shares you have and so on. And you can also integrate it with some monitoring tools like Nagios or OpenNMS. So we already have a few nice features. There's a user survey app, for example. So in Nextcloud, the next version, people can send us some information back, how to use it, what I like, what I don't like, how they use the software, which helps us to improve it, and so on. So there's already a few improvements. But this is, again, only the first step because we are just, as I said, a few weeks old. We are already planning Nextcloud 11 for later, and for that we really have a lot of interesting things planned. But all this planning, again, this happens in the open. If you're interested, you can go to github.com/nextcloud, and you can see all the planning and everything there, and everybody can say their opinions and contribute, so really open.
So we do have a question from the chat room. We always like to get these in when we have questions from the chat room. This question is from Randall Schwartz, who's in the chat room today.
All right, cool.
Why not, right? He's been talking it up in the chat room, and he's got a question about the iOS and Android clients, I believe, and what they're written in. Is it one code base compiled to two languages or separate code bases?
They are separate code bases. So there are separate code bases. The Android is written in Java, and the iOS one is written in Objective-C. So yeah, they're native apps. I mean, there's always a discussion. There are some technologies where we can write it once with Mono, for example, and cross-compile it to different platforms. But usually, you have some drawbacks. You can't always use all the native APIs and so on. So we have native apps. Yeah. Oh yeah, I know that. That's awesome.
That's so awesome. I have a question. I don't have a question about this for you, Frank.
Yes.
So you know. It's all very well. ownCloud's all very well, but it has the same problem that Dropbox has got, which is that all the files are stored in a place. And yeah. That means that's a place the police can raid. That's a place the equipment can break. That's a place the service provider can decide to throw you out of. Do you have any plans for Nextcloud to use distributed storage rather than centralized storage?
Yeah. In fact, we do. In fact, we do. But this will most likely mean that we will that we want to work together with someone. So we don't want to write a complete distributed file system or storage in Nextcloud itself. But we will most likely. I don't want to say too much at the moment because I don't like to talk about features that don't work yet. But we'll, the idea is that we work together with some of the people who already have successful different distributed storage systems and then have native integration. So I couldn't agree more. I mean, the thing is that if you run your own Dropbox, Google Drive replacement at home, that's all great. But of course, at the end of the day, you want to all to work together with other people outside your home. And we have this federation feature where we can work together, and then we will also have some interesting distributed storage features. But yeah, this will take a few more weeks.
Right. So, you know, speaking as somebody who's involved with LibreOffice, I would love to see LibreOffice to have a distributed storage capability built into it. So if you want to come along to the LibreOffice conference in Brno in a couple of weeks.
I would love to.
Talk with people about it. I would love to get some sort of distributed storage program up and running so that everyone who has a copy of LibreOffice installed is automatically contributing storage to and sharing storage with a distributed cloud. So maybe if you send me an email, come along, we can talk about it with people in Brno.
Very cool. Let's do that.
So that could be like a distributed, just so similar as Microsoft is doing their Office 365 stuff and their cloud stuff. I mean, this could be the answer, right? The open source answer to that.
Absolutely. You know, the problem with the open source stuff that Carl is well aware of is that, you know, it's all very well storing software in the cloud, but, you know, there is no cloud. You know, the cloud is just a computer that is being run by some company whose priority is making money and complying with police instructions. And if there's some reason they have to take you offline, they'll take you offline and they'll ask questions about it afterward. So one of the big priorities for open and free software is to get distributed again. And you know, that's one of Tim Berners-Lee's big moves is to re-decentralize the internet.
Absolutely.
So, you know, it's great if Frank wants to do that.
I mean, not alone, obviously, but that's exactly the goal. So, as you said, cloud as an idea that you don't have to run all your infrastructure on your own, that's great, right? Maybe you can, I don't know, ask someone else to run your infrastructure, that's great. But the trend that basically everything is now done by a few big corporations, right? I mean, there's like Microsoft and Google and Amazon and like one or two others, but that's it. And it seems that those guys that run like the infrastructure and the communication and file exchange for most of the people on this planet. And that's a bit strange. I don't think this was the idea of the internet or the web in the first place. So I completely agree with this Tim here and with all the others that distributed federated architecture is really, we want to get back to that. And the same in a lot of areas, the same with messengers, right? If you look at all the messengers on mobile phones nowadays, or if you look at social networking, Facebook, Twitter, they're all very centralized data silos, centralized services. And I think there are better ways to do that.
And so just in terms of, as you're talking, I was just thinking, though, in terms of cloud, I mean, you could have this distributed over multiple clouds, right? So if Amazon decides to pull the plug, you're still up and running.
Yep.
Yeah, so that's one way to skin the cat, I guess. It's almost time to wrap up. I did want to ask how I want to be discreet here, but you know, we've talked a lot about the differences between ownCloud and Nextcloud and all that. I don't want to focus so much on that, but I am curious what the transition's been like. So have people been transitioning from ownCloud to Nextcloud? Are companies using Nextcloud like internally or externally to share documents? Mm-hmm. Can you give us a sense of, you know, what the current state of affairs is in terms of people either shifting to Nextcloud or using Nextcloud in a big way?
Yeah, I mean, I don't have any hard numbers. It's a bit hard to say, but what we see is really, really amazing. So if you see like the momentum on our forums, on the ISC channels, like on GitHub, I mean, it seems that people really like the idea behind Nextcloud. It seems that a lot of people moved over to Nextcloud from ownCloud, from the contributor, from the open source space. Then, of course, there are also like the big companies, the customers. We are totally flooded here at Nextcloud, at Nextcloud company at the moment by customer requests. And we already signed up quite a few big ones, and there will be some announcements very soon. And we really, it really seems that the idea behind this resonates very well, because it's funny. We have to understand that, like, a pure open source business model, this is what we do here. We don't do open core, it's pure open source. Also, not only benefits the contributors, because their contribution is protected, but it also contributes the customers. Because if you have an open core business model, if you decide that you don't no longer want to pay the company, then you lose the right to use this proprietary code. It's the complete proprietary business model, the same way you have with Microsoft and Apple and others. But we, with a complete open source business model, this is something that the customers also really like, because it protects their investment. It basically is something that they can build a long-term strategy, a long-term infrastructure on top of. So I can't really answer your question. I don't have any statistics here at the moment, but it seems that there's a big shift going on. Yeah,
and there's also a quick question from the chat room. Again, we'd love to get these in if we can. Crucial Wax wants to know if he can upgrade his own cloud to Nextcloud. We talked about this a little bit before, but Is there an easy way to do it? Because I noticed, for example, you know, I just did, as we were talking, apt-get remove ownCloud on my little chip computer, and I tried to do apt-get install Nextcloud, and there doesn't seem to be any packages or Debian repositories for Nextcloud. So talk about first of all, how easy is it? And second of all, when are the Debian repositories come?
So you use Debian, right? So we don't have any Debian packages yet. We are working on that, and we hope to have this very, very soon, especially now for the Nextcloud 10 release that will come out really soon. That we hope that we have packages for all, at least for Debian and maybe for a few other distributions. This is something that will be fixed over time. It's just... we can't do everything at once, so this is why the packages come in a few days or weeks. But if you have that, then upgrading is really, really easy. You can, as you said, just remove the old package and install the new one, and then this will work. If you want to do the manual upgrade, which is, by the way, really, really easy, so you don't really need distribution packages, you can just download the zip file and unpack it on your Apache. Maybe you replace your own cloud folder directly or put it into a parallel folder, and then it's already working. So manual upgrade or manual install sounds a bit scary, but in the case of Nextcloud, it's just basically unzipping a tar zip file or a tar file, and that's it. After that, everything works. So the configuration is still there, the database is still there, all user accounts are there, files are there. It's really, really easy. And there's already, if you look at, I think on YouTube, there are already some tutorial videos how to do that, and there's blog posts and information on our website. It's really easy.
Yeah, there. I was just going to say there are a lot of – I was just searching while you guys were talking. There are a lot of websites that tell how to do it or how to install it from scratch if you want to. Yep. If you're a Linux geek, it's not going to be too, too difficult, although I would say it'll be nice when those repositories come out for those of us who for those people who maybe aren't as proficient in running a LAMP server or something like that. So I hope that comes soon. We need to wrap it up. We're kind of at the end of the show here, and I apologize. We talked for a long time. We had all that stuff in the beginning, so thank you for your patience with that. But is there anything else we didn't ask that you want to make sure people know about Nextcloud? Maybe how to get involved, for example?
Yeah, I mean, we are really, really open, an open project. So if you want to get involved, you can directly jump to GitHub, github.com/nextcloud, and you can see all the issues and the roadmap and the code and everything, and you can comment and give feedback. Or we really have a very, very nice forum and discussion place. If you can go to help.nextcloud.com, that's also a good way to ask questions and discuss and get in contact with the community. And there's actually another thing I want to mention. So we are doing a big conference in Berlin. In September, it's September 16th to 22nd in Berlin at the Technical University there. So if you're in the area, then join us. There will be interesting talks, there will be nice keynotes, and there will be a few surprise announcements too. And of course, also an opportunity to code and contribute and get involved.
Awesome. Awesome. So usually at the end of the show, we do a couple of questions, favorite scripting language, favorite editor. But I think you answered those probably on the last show you were on. So I'm going to leave that as a tease for people to go back and listen to that show. So I'm going to ask you a couple different questions just to mix things up.
Okay,
a little bit.
Of course.
So the first one is, what Linux distribution would you be most likely to run at home if you had to pick one?
I think it depends. I mean, on servers, I usually run Debian because this is something where I really don't want to have a lot of. It should just work. On a desktop at home, I use Ubuntu. That's a bit boring, right? It's a mainstream desktop Linux, and also I have a very strong KDE background, and I run still a lot of KDE applications. But I like Ubuntu at the moment.
Yeah, well, that's Debian-based. So the next question why not? The next question is, what's your favorite open hardware platform? So if you had to choose between Raspberry Pi or chip or even if it's not completely open, we'll take any answer there. Is there one that you have heard about or you like more than others?
Good question. I think from a hardware perspective, there are a lot of interesting projects. And like the Banana Pi, for example, is really nice. You get nice performance from it. Usually, if I play around with something, I just use plain old boring Raspberry Pi because there's usually most software and most documentation for it. But I understand that nowadays there are other projects where you get a little bit more bang for the buck. I use a Raspberry Pi a lot, like for a home media center and just from some other projects I do. Yeah,
excellent. Well, that last question was a little self-serving, but you know, I didn't want to ask you the same questions that we had already asked, so I had to come up with a couple different ones. So good. Glad to hear it. There's nothing wrong with the Raspberry Pi, you know? That's a lot of community
it's a bit
support.
Boring. I mean, everybody, it's stable and always available, and yeah.
Right. And I always tell people there's so much community support for Raspberry Pi. And in a lot of ways, the open source community, I mean, that's one of the benefits of doing things with open source is that you get that community benefit. There's a lot of people that will jump on board because you don't have to necessarily, play the corporate things and hire them and do all that stuff. It's like they can just contribute to a project. There's a lot of the restrictions are gone. Anyway, don't want to get off on a tangent. Frank, thanks for being with us today. Really appreciate it. This has been great.
Thanks
and I
lot.
Hope everybody goes out and tries Nextcloud. So really good to speak to you again.
Thanks. Thanks for having me. And have a great day. Have a great great show. And again, congratulations to 400. That's a big impressive number.
thank you so much. Simon, what do you think about Nextcloud?
I think it's the inevitable consequence of using the wrong corporate rules on an open source project. You get the community eventually decides that it's not going to take the restrictions. And I think the result is going to be great things for the Nextcloud project. I hope that they can get the community support that they need and get the partnerships with businesses to make sure that they can make a profit and invest more in free software. And I'm really looking forward to hearing what Frank's going to do about distributed storage, because personally, I'm very unhappy using cloud services because I know that the only person that has really got my interests at heart is me. And I would much rather store all of my valuable files in a place that's got my interests at heart.
Right. Right. Absolutely. And the thing that impresses me about this is that, you know, so rarely do you find a company or a group that, you know, goes down one path and starts to close things off a little bit and then decides to actually turn that around and change it for the better. And it seems like, you know, Frank and his whole crew have really done that in this regard. They're going in the right direction now. Usually it doesn't end up that way. Usually people start going down that path and then they continue on and they get locked in, and it's almost like there's no turning back once they've headed down that dark road. But it seems like Nextcloud is really taking the right direction here. And so I'm really glad to see that the path that they're on. And I know I'm going to go out and I'm going to try to install Nextcloud, even though it's a little bit more difficult at the moment. I'm going to go do it and get it up and running and see what the differences are for myself. So that's as soon as we get done with the podcast. Anyway, anything that you want to plug? Actually, let's talk about upcoming episodes real quick, and then I'll let you do some plugs, Simon. So episode 401, man, that's a lot, big number, is coming up very soon on August 30th. Will Hayes is going to be joining us to talk about LucidWorks, which is an intelligent enterprise search engine, so somewhat related to what we've been talking about today, but that's based on Apache Solr and Apache Spark. So that's going to be interesting to see what they're doing in terms of search, enterprise search. And then on September 6th, Pino De Candia is going to join us to talk about Midikura, which is an enterprise virtual network management software built on open source MitoNet, which is an open source project. So we'll talk about that. September 13th, Josh Berkus is coming. He was one of the very first guests on this show. Talk about history. I believe he was probably talking about PostgreSQL back when he was on before. But he's going to be coming on to talk about Project Atomic, which is, they describe it as, the ability to use immutable infrastructure to deploy and scale your containerized applications on a next-generation container OS. So I think they built this platform specifically for containers, and maybe it'll solve some of Simon's concerns about running these things on someone else's hardware and not having control. And then on September 20th, Jared Smith is going to be on to talk about Capital One Open, which I believe, you know, Capital One's a big bank, and they contribute a lot of code to open source and have a lot of open source projects themselves going on. So we're going to find out about how this big, you know, commercial entity actually gets involved with open source. So that should be really, really interesting. Now, Simon, do you have anything to plug?
I do, as it happens. So, first of all, you can find everything that I'm writing and doing at my personal website, which is webmink.com, or at my company website, meshedinsights.com, you can get to from there. I'm going to be speaking at the Free Software Foundation Europe's very first summit in Berlin. That's starting at the end of the first week in September, on September 2nd. And I'm going to be speaking about the new nonprofit that I've started, which is called Public Software, which is a hosting, a legal entity host for open source projects. So Carl could have brought Nextcloud to us to host his trademarks and his assets so the community could be protected without all the hard work of starting his own nonprofit foundation. I'll be at the FSFE summit that weekend, the 2nd. A few weeks later, I'll be in Brno in the Czech Republic, starting from the 7th of September for the LibreOffice conference. If you use LibreOffice and you live in Europe, you really ought to come along to that conference. It's going to be 3 days of technical and community presentations about the LibreOffice project. Now that it's 5 years old, it's part of a big, successful community of hundreds of people. And it's got an exciting future as a cloud-hosted application, but one you can host yourself. You can download the container and host that yourself. And then in October, I'm going to be speaking at OSCON Europe, and I would be very pleased to see anyone there. That's going to be the 18th and 19th of October. And if you watch my Twitter feed, I'll be posting a link to get you a 20% discount on tickets for that conference. So follow me as Webmink on Twitter. You'll find me as Simon Phipps on Google Plus. And you'll find me under one of those two names on pretty much everything else as well. That's everything that I wanted to plug. Back to you, Aaron.
Wow, that's everything. It's no wonder we have a hard time getting you on the show sometimes because you're so busy. Highly recommend anytime you can get out to hear Simon talk about any subject involving the open source ecosystem. I highly recommend it. So if you can get to any of those things that he's going to be at, it's going to be well worth it. You're going to want to go check him out. Also, I just want to note, you know, Randall's been in the chat room today, and he wants to let everyone say hi to everyone and let everyone know that he's very thankful for the kind thoughts that everyone's been sending his way. He is healing, although slowly, and he's going to be back as soon as possible. That's direct from Randall in the chat room. So again, good luck to Randall. We hope that he does heal quickly and gets better as soon as possible. In terms of myself, you can follow me on any of the social networks. I'm Aaron Newcomb. You can also follow me, of course, here on the twit.tv network of shows. I'm here on Floss Weekly. I'm also on the new Screensavers and This Week in Google and All About Android and those types of shows. So just definitely follow me on this network. In terms of this show, though, you can follow this show at Floss Weekly on Twitter, plus Floss Weekly on Google+. Join the chat room, definitely. I know it's early for some people, late for others. Definitely join the chat room because we love to take questions from the chat room. That's irc.twit.tv. And you can always watch the show live at live.twit.tv. That'll wrap it up for this episode. Until next time, we'll see you very soon on episode 401. Can you believe it? That's coming up next time on Floss Weekly.